The election is 23 days away, and the close of nominations last week has confirmed the runners and riders, 3,322 people seeking a place on the green benches. Yet despite the enthusiasm of the thousands, from Advance Together, five candidates, to the Young People's Party UK, three candidates, most seats remain a foregone conclusion. Unless you live in one of the few dozen battleground seats, you can already know who your MP will be. For these candidates, the toughest electoral test they faced in 2019 will be long gone, this election. Though the parties differ in many things, the way to make it onto a ballot is largely similar. Parties approve a central list, narrow candidates down to seat shortlists, and then dispatch them to local party meetings. After a brief Q&A in a draughty church hall, local members vote, and whoever has wowed the assembled hundred or so moves forward. The approval of a fewer than 50 people can easily propel you to a majority of 20,000 plus. Popular reports suggest that this is a process rife with patronage, schemes, and stitch-ups. That all of the major parties have had to sack candidates between selection and the election shows its failings, with obvious incidents of sexism and antisemitism, for example, coming to light only after a candidate has been garlanded. The selection of candidates is perhaps the most important and least understood aspect of our democratic system. Those who go into parliament shape politics at the highest level. They vote on legislation, speak in debates, and make up crucial select committees, but they also have a large hand in selecting the leaders of both major parties. That means, indirectly, that local party members can have a surprising amount of influence. It is worth remembering that if three Labour members in Islington's 1983 selection had voted differently, we might never have heard of Jeremy Corbyn. The cohort of MPs tends to reflect both the spirit of the age and the peculiar concerns of local people. Glancing back across the makeup of the Commons since the war, it is clear how the green benches have undergone a transformation. The most obvious is the advance of women MPs. Until the 1980s, no more than 5% of parliamentarians at any time were female. It is now one-third, and is set to rise again this time around. Equally, there is far more representation by individuals from minority ethnic backgrounds, 8%, and openly LGBTQ people, 7%, even if these numbers lag behind the general population. These figures, however, mask the broader cultural changes that have run through Parliament. The initial post-war parliaments were a curious mix of largely patrician Tories, well-educated and from wealthy families, and Labour members who had often risen up literally from the coalface. Both groups have declined. Since the 1970s, the proportion of Conservative MPs educated for more on this story, visit the news article link.